Hello everyone. Today our topic is on wearable ecosystem and Bluetooth attacking the Bluetooth low energy design and implementation on mobile phones. Let's get started. Before that, quick introduction about us. I am Sunil, working as principal security analyst in dparmer. Before this, I was in Ola security team and Ericsson technology. Today I have with me Nitin Lakshmanan. He is also a principal security analyst in dparmer. Before this, he was in Aegis Networks and Ericsson Technology. Regarding dparmer, it's a security consulting firm. We do penetration testing, vulnerability assessments for our client, and we also provide various security trainings to organizations. Today's agenda is, first we will explain about the IoT ecosystem. Then we talk about challenges faced in securing these never-before gadgets. Then we talk about Bluetooth and BLE security. And Nitin will be showing some cool demos on how to sniff the traffic and how to eavesdrop on the data. Finally, we conclude our presentation with proposal on securing these kind of gadgets. Yeah, this is how a IoT ecosystem looks like. It has mainly four components, mobile phones, cloud, hardware devices, and the protocol. Let's take an example of home automation. In a home automation system, there will be devices called as nodes, which will be having sensors, will be deployed across the house. And this will be collecting information like temperature, fire alarms, home security alarms, and more. At regular intervals, this node will be sending information to the gateway through the low power consuming protocols like Zigbee, Z-Wave. Gateway being the device which computes the larger part, it sends this sensor information to the backend services, which will be deployed on the cloud. This cloud can be private or public cloud. We know that well-known public clouds like Amazon, GCP, and Azure. User of the home automation can use the mobile application that you see on the right side to see the or monitor the house at any given point. And this mobile phones can also be used to configure the gateway through Bluetooth, BLE, or Wi-Fi direct. In some IoT ecosystems, these mobile phones can be eliminated where the larger part of computations will be done on the gateway. One more interesting factor is there can be multiple nodes and multiple gateways across the system. It is not restricted to one gateway or one node. Based on the requirement of the product, these can be multiplied. Yeah, let's take a case study of in-ear fitness coach. This is a headphone device which is mainly used for the athletes to improve their athletics activities. It can be worn during the running, it can be worn during the cycling, and it does a lot more by taking instructions. It's a wearable, so it should be comfortable, and it should be smart enough to take the user commands and respond back. And it should also be untethered because no users like to use their gadgets with wire dangling around them. And it should have a feature like continuous learning to see the activities of user and provide inputs based on the activities done by the user. Overall, it should improve the quality of life of a user. And one more interesting thing is users like to see their activities in pictorial representation and not just in the plain text. There are quite challenges in securing these kind of gadgets, because our traditional SDLC frameworks are mainly applied for products which run for a long time and with a constant requirement. But whereas in these type of gadgets, time to it to market will be very less, and the requirements can be continuously evolving. And when we see protocols for these kind of gadgets, you will be ending up with around 30 to 40 different low power consuming protocols. So choosing a proper protocol for your product will be one more difficult job. And when we choose a proper protocol, adoption of this protocol for your device will be one more big factor. So we have a demo on this, on how a weak adoption of protocol can lead to data eavesdropping. Another few factors are longevity of the IoT products and privacy. And there is not much research on this IoT security section also. There are few technical challenges as well. As we know that these wearables will be collecting a lot of information like geolocation of user, biometric data, sensor data, and even some wearable devices will accept the payment as well. So securing these kind of gadgets is must. So these gadgets will be running with limited software stack. They will be running firmware with less kilobytes. So implementing security features on these type of device will be little difficult and quite challenging also. Security requirements like Diffie-Hellman key exchange process, trusted execution environments are little bit challenging. And along with the hardware device, we need to protect our cloud and the mobile applications as well. Yeah, let's jump into the BLE part. This BLE is a subset of Bluetooth. It will be used for short-range data exchange thing. It operates at frequency 2.4 to 2.485 gigahertz, and its range varies from 10 to 600 meters. This Bluetooth is maintained and organized, governed by the Bluetooth SIG group. The recent version of Bluetooth is 5.0. We know that this Bluetooth is widely used in various sectors like wearable devices, healthcare systems, earphones, and more. Coming to the pairing mechanism, there are mainly four pairing mechanisms. This secure simple pairing is introduced from Bluetooth version 2.1. This mainly simplifies the pairing mechanism of Bluetooth device. As I told, there are four mechanisms. One is JestWork, where there is no user interface and there will be no user authentication. The temporary key will be all six zeros. Whereas in the numeric comparison, there will be a button and a display. User should press yes or no, seeing the pin on the display. The third one is passkey entry, where the device will be having a display and a keypad to enter the pin. The last one is out-of-band signal pairing. The user authentication will be done based through the another protocols like NFC or Wi-Fi Direct to exchange the primary temporary key. After exchanging this temporary keys and ending up with the long-term key, the traffic will be encrypted using AES-128 algorithm. The more about key will be explained in the later part of the presentation. There are a few weaknesses in the Bluetooth or BLE protocol. The security of the communication mainly depends upon the pairing algorithm that we just saw. Just works, as I said, the temporary key will be 000000. So it is mainly prone to a man-in-the-middle kind of attack. And if somebody sniffs all the packets related to pairing, they can extract the or exfiltrate the long-term key. We have a demo for this and we will be showing that. And finally, apps on the phone. This is one interesting part that there are chances that malware applications on the phone can sniff your BLE data. I'm adding it to Nitin. You'll be showing demos and explaining the vulnerabilities in this.
Thank you, Sunil. Hello, everyone. So as Sunil explained, we are going to get into a few demos. We have recorded demos with us. And you can see that these are the two devices which are in talk now for the demos. So first one, the golden colored one, is the Fossil Q Dreamer developed by Intel. And second one is a popular fitness tracker device. And these are fitness tracker device and they give you notifications, calculate your steps, calories, and give the inputs to the mobile devices. And we have discovered these problems in the ecosystem, in this Bluetooth ecosystem, and we have responsibly disclosed these vulnerabilities. So these are the tools which we are going to use. The first one is the Ubertooth one, which is an open source Bluetooth tool, and it is used for pen testing and all other sniffing activities. It is developed by Great Scott Gadgets, and it works on the 2.4 gigahertz frequency. And the second one is Wireshark. As you many of the people know, it is a network packet analyzing tool. And we are going to use another tool called Crackle, which is developed by Micreon. We will be seeing about this in the later slides. So this is how the setup looks like. So we have the Ubertooth one connected to the system, which is displayed there on the left side. So that is the Ubertooth one. And it is going to sniff the traffic between the mobile device and the devices, the smart devices, wearable devices. So this is what we are expected. Expectation is that when this device, fitness tracker, communicates with the mobile phone, we will be able to capture the activity data like step count and calories in an unencrypted environment. So we will be showing the steps to capture and the other things in the second part of the exercise. So the first part, we have already captured it, and we are going to display you the packet captured using Wireshark. So this is how the packet looked like when we captured it between the device and the phone. So you can see that the unencrypted BLE attributes and the other GAT characteristics are visible in this packets. And also you can, as we did some research to find the step count and calories, we found the offsets. And you can see at the bottom, we have highlighted the step count and calories, which are being transferred from the mobile, from the device to the mobile. So this brings to the concept of LTK, because you can see that in this communication, everything was unencrypted. So this brings to LTK, which is long-term key. This key will be used for encrypting the Bluetooth communication. So the process is like when the phone will send a request for pairing, and the device will respond with the pairing response. And once it is exchanged, there will be a temporary key exchange, like one of the methods which was previously explained by Sunil. And using this temporary key, we will be generating a slave random number, a master random number. And using these three values, there will be a short-term key developed. So this short-term key is used for encrypting the long-term key. So a long-term key will be generated, and it will be encrypted using the short-term key and then sent between the devices. So now this communication, which is happening between the device and the phone, will be encrypted using LTK, that is the long-term key, along with this many other keys like IRK and CSRK for identity resolving keys, and this signature resolving keys will be transferred in this process. So this was how the connection for agreement for LTK happened. So the pairing request, then the pairing response from the mobile, then establish the short-term key and the encrypt and send the long-term key. Once it is agreed, the connection will be, the communication between the device and the phone will be encrypted. So now we are going to see how it happens. So for this, we are going to take the FossilQ Dreamer. As previously explained, this device has no display, it sends your calories and step count and other notifications. So this FossilQ Dreamer uses the LTK key to encrypt the communication between the device and the phone. So this is the expectation now. So when we capture the traffic between the device and the phone, we are expected to get the encrypted step count and calories. As previously we saw in the previous example, we were getting unencrypted step count and calories. We will be getting encrypted packet here. So let's jump into the demo. So now what we are going to do is we are going to start the Ubertooth application, and we are going to use Wireshark to display the captured packets from the Ubertooth tool. So we have created a pipe and we are going to listen in the Ubertooth device. So once the Ubertooth device is started, you will be able to see lots of traffic being generated. Because there will be lots of Bluetooth devices around you sending discovery packets and other packets. So now you can see lots of data is being already generated in the traffic. And we are interested in a particular packet, which is the connection packet. So now we are going to pair the fossil device to the phone. And while it is pairing, we are going to capture the pairing request and response. So we have applied filters for that, and we are waiting for the pairing to happen. So once the pairing happens, we will be able to see the L2 cap fragments. We are able to see the L2 cap fragments, and we are also able to see the LL encryption request, LL encryption response, and start encryption. So once this is where the LTK key is transferred between the devices, and once it is transferred, the entire communication is L2 cap fragments. So previously, if you remember in the screenshot which we showed for the previous device, it was able to display the ATT and the other GAT characteristics of Bluetooth. But we are now having only the encrypted communication. So does this mean that LTK is enough to secure your communication, like between the devices and the phone? No. So what we can do is, there is a tool called Crackle developed by MicRayan, which exploits this flaw in BLE pairing process, and it will be able to generate the temporary key and also figure out the short-term key, which leads to the long-term key. So we will run the captured PCAP, the traffic which we have captured for this process, and we'll send it to this Crackle tool. So now we will be saving this packet, and we will be showing how it can be used against the Crackle tool. So we are going to pass this PCAP to the Crackle device, and you will be able to see that Crackle has already decoded, and it has decrypted, and it has found the LTK key. As it is using just work mechanism, like just works like 0000 as the temporary key, Crackle was able to crack it very quickly on the first attempt, and it was able to generate the LTK key as well. So now it shows that having LTK key is not, LTK encryption is not enough, and we are able to simply crack it using a tool. And we will be showing that same PCAP file decrypted in the Wireshark now. So once the filter is applied, we will be able to see all the communication. So now you can see that all the ATT and the GAT characteristics and all the offsets which are transferred between the phone and the device are being captured there. There is no encryption of L2 PCAPs only. There are all other informations which we are looking for in the packet. So what had happened now is, the Fossil device was trying to pair with the mobile phone, and we are able to sniff the traffic using Ubertooth, and we have ended up with the encrypted packets. And this encrypted packets, when passed to the Crackle, we are able to get the decrypted packet. So does this mean that Crackle Fossil is broken? Is it vulnerable to any attacks? Before we get the conclusion, we will also see in another form of vulnerability, where how another ecosystem challenge can cause the problems in Bluetooth communication. Over to you, Sunil.
Thank you, Nitin. Yeah, let's look into the another challenge in the ecosystem. For this, we will be mainly concentrating on mobile application and the device, and we will be seeing the Bluetooth and BLE traffic here. Yeah. This is how a communication happens between device and phone. You can see there is a lot of data exchanging between these two. Mobile application sends commands like firmware updates, change the BLE name, social app notifications. Even some wearables are capable of accepting a call and replying to the text. Whereas from the device to mobile, it will be mainly about the activities, responses to the messages from applications, social app notifications, and more. So as Nitin explained, this traffic will be encrypted encrypted using the LTK key. So if attacker sniffs this traffic, you will be ending up with the garbage data that is encrypted data. So the problem really comes when there is a malware application sitting on the mobile itself. So what happens here is when the data reaches the Bluetooth layer, Bluetooth layer decrypts the encrypted BLE data and sends it to the application layer. So any app on the application layer with Bluetooth permissions can access the unencrypted BLE data and sniff all the data. In this case, it can be OTP, it can be step count, or it can be any personal data that exchanges between these two. For the root cause of this problem is because in the BLE, in the Bluetooth spec itself, it is mentioned any application with Bluetooth or Bluetooth admin permission, they can read the BLE characteristics just like the legitimate app. So in Android, a malware application needs Bluetooth or Bluetooth admin permission, whereas in the iOS, a core Bluetooth framework permissions are required. So here you can see the highlighted part. It says in the Bluetooth spec, admin Bluetooth admin permissions will be coming with other capabilities also, but applications should not misuse it to any other extent. So now we have seen LTK can be cracked, malware application can read your BLE data. Does this mean Fossil device is broken? The answer is no, because the Fossil uses one more extra layer of protection, that is application level encryption. During the initial stages, the Fossil device and the Fossil application will be exchanging application level secret. This secret will be used to encrypt all the data exchanging between the device and the application. So if somebody over the air can use Crackle and crack the LTK, but they will be ending up with the encrypted packets, encrypted data through the application secret. Similarly, malware application reading the unencrypted data, unencrypted BLE data will also be seeing the encrypted data that is done through the application secret. So the Fossil is not broken because it is using the application level secret. And this is the recommended way to implement BLE security or Bluetooth security in the wearable devices. So the proposal for these kind of devices is we need to use the tailored SDLC procedure that apps based on the requirements and the time to hit the market for these next generation devices. And it is also necessary to use the shift left policy, that is to bring the security in the early stages of the product itself. Another important thing is we need to include privacy in the SDLC procedure, and also we should adapt to industry standards like OWASP, NIST, CWE, and more. And we have seen that when these different four components are coming together, there will be a lot of new issues rising in the ecosystem itself. So it is important to secure the components individually and when they are integrated as well. That's how we conclude our presentation. We'll be in the work adventure to take up the Q&A. Hope you guys enjoyed this.